Hello and welcome to One on One. My name is Tunde Asaju, and on this edition of One on One, we will be speaking to Ojo Maduekwe, His Excellency, the Nigerian High Commissioner to Canada. Chief Ojo Maduekwe does not need too many introductions. He's been minister for this and minister of that, if we are going to talk in the Nigerian parlance. But today he sits on the seat of the High Commissioner here in Ottawa, Canada. You're welcome to this program, sir.
Thank you very much, Tunde.
Becoming a High Commissioner, starts with first becoming a politician. At what point did you in your life think, oh, I think I want to leave law and go and serve the people in a political capacity?
I was called to the Nigerian bar in 1973. And got a position in one of the leading law firms in Nigeria, one of the best, Kehinde Shofola and Co., where I had the privilege of working there as a young associate. Later on, I set out to have my own law firm. We're based in Western House in Lagos. A very important address for lawyers in those days who had a good practice, and I had a good one, a very promising practice. But I suddenly felt the pull of politics. I felt that politics provided the widest platform to impact on the society, on the community, and that drove me into enlisting in the then National Party of Nigeria, NPN, in 79. So it's been a long period of public service. If we had to add from when I got elected in 83 to now, serving as High Commissioner, you are looking at a period of 3 decades.
So after, 3 decades in public service, does politics become part of your blood?
Politics is a great opportunity for one to multiply one's impact. When I was Minister of Transport, I took quite some important decisions that helped the economy bring down the cost of goods because of the reforms we did in the ports. Created a lot of jobs because of those reforms. And of course, I was the first Minister of Transport to design a master plan for integrated transportation called MITI. That master plan is what is informing government policy on transportation up to now. No profession, whether law or medicine or engineering, can give one that kind of force multiplier capability. Politics is a platform for doing maximum good within our secular human environment. It can also be a platform for maximum evil. The call of politics is very important for good people. As Edmund Burke used to say, to move into the political space, because failure of good people to move into the political space means that bad people will hijack that platform and create huge suffering.
In the case of Nigeria, what would you say? Is it for the maximum good or is it for maximum damage from your assessment?
I know it's fashionable for us to engage in self-deprecation. Often the legitimate exercise of self-criticism often gets pathological in my beloved country, and that means that we don't give ourselves enough credit for what we have done well. We seem to really enjoy deconstructing ourselves and deconstructing leaders. We do not even admit the need to have myths that can become the vehicle for national empowerment. And myths are myths. They are not accurate in every detail. Take a man like George Washington, who is venerated, Thomas Jefferson. George Washington was a slave owner. Jefferson was a slave owner. Abraham Lincoln is described not the most, didn't have the most impressive of personalities, suffered from what today may be described as clinical depression, or melancholy and all that. These were leaders with major flaws. But then they are out there at Mount Rushmore, where Americans literally, without being idolatrous about it, worship their, what they represent, worship their memory. And that sense of celebration of leadership creates the myth that drives progress in America. My take on that, therefore, is that many of our leaders in the past gave of their best to our nation. Were they perfect? No. Were they missed opportunities? Yes. Couldn't they have taken us to the promised land faster? Of course, yes. But I think there's need for a more balanced narrative here. And I am convinced that the fact that Nigeria is arguably the only remaining federation from the British Empire, the only one that has survived, speaks volumes to the genius of Nigerian leadership. But in 2015, it's time for us not to be frozen in the past. It's time for us to now begin to engage the future by counting our blessings and moving forward.
Good. You survived four basic governments. Well, people can say there were four governments formed by the same party, but four governments run by different individuals all the same. What's your strategy, survival strategy?
That's a good question. Frankly, I had no strategy other than to deal with the task at hand and give of my best to it. To realize that it's a privilege to serve, especially to serve as a minister of the Federal Republic, which I didn't lobby for. But I was lucky. There were people who knew me before President Obasanjo appointed me as minister who went to him and said, it's a minister from each state. If you go to Abia State, look at a guy called Ojo Maduekwe. We know him. He has integrity. He's very loyal. He's very hardworking. And the rest is history. President Obasanjo tried that. It's an experiment. He tried it. And within 1 year, I was minister of the new pioneer minister of culture and tourism. He felt there was a more challenging role for me in the complex, corrupt-ridden Ministry of Transportation. And of course, I now felt even challenged to move things to an unprecedented level in the fight against corruption, because I remained very, very proud and grateful to God for the courage and wisdom he gave me to start the first anti-corruption unit in government. I remember I was in Hanover for the World Expo as Minister of Tourism and Culture when I was called by one of my aides that there had just been a cabinet reshuffle. And it's been announced you are going to be Minister of Transport. So when I had that announcement, I knelt down. I said, well, God, I didn't know this was coming. You know why I'm being sent there. I remember that prayer was specific. I said, give me the courage of Daniel and the wisdom of Solomon. Let me do something new in the new ministry, in the place I'm going to, in the Ministry of Transport. So when I came back, I just said, well, from what I hear about Ministry of Transport, because what happens in the ports, the revenue generating agencies like what is Nigerian Maritime Authority and all that. It seems to be like many other aspects of government life, a place of a lot of patronage without rules, corruption and all that. And since President Obasanjo had made the fight against corruption a linchpin of his administration, there were two bills he first went to the National Assembly with. One is the anti-corruption bill, the ICPC, that gave birth to ICPC, and one NDDC, possibly a linkage between the two. I'm his minister. My duty here is to give robust expression to the president's mission. And somebody has to put into practice what the president is talking about. And transport is as good as any platform to give experience to that. So I wrote to the president. No minister was invited to write any such proposal, but I wrote, voluntarily, I wrote to the president, judge me as to how I will have succeeded or failed as your minister to, in the way I'm going to fight corruption. I want to, with the approval, establish anti-corruption unit. None existed. The ICPC bill had not been passed by parliament. Some of the governors had taken the president to court on that bill. I could have waited till the matter was resolved. I didn't wait. The president said, go ahead. That's how we started the anti-corruption unit. And of course, that led to a lot of casualties, some cleaning up of the ministry. That anti-corruption unit, because government was very impressed, they now took it as a pilot scheme. In fact, Transparency International wrote to us, wrote to me, wrote to the government that they wanted to work with us. And they came. The executive director of Transparency International came and worked with us and recommended what we had done. And the chairman of ICPC, Justice Akambi, met with us, commended us, wrote us a letter of commendation, and spoke at every public forum that the Ministry of Transport under Ojo Maduekwe was the most impressive ministry in tackling the issues of public integrity and the fight against corruption. Government then made it a rule that every ministry, every MDA should have anti-corruption in it. I named it Anti-Corruption and Transparency Monitoring Unit. It was my name, my naming, because some people just, why not just anti-corruption? I said, no, transparency is even a higher order than anti-corruption. That is the name it's called in every MDA of government. At the last count, I'm told by the former secretary of ICPC that you have about 750 anti-corruption units in Nigeria today. That was as a result of my initiative. Of all the many things I did in government, if I'm asked to name which one I find to be, from my perspective, most important and most critical, I would say it was that initiative in kicking off anti-corruption. Because fighting corruption is key to re-engineering the Nigerian state. And for me to be in a very rich ministry, a ministry of transport, and said this is where I'm going, and then said I will lead by example. I made an announcement that if anybody gave my wife, Mrs. Maduekwe, any contract, I'll throw you out of the ministry. If anybody named Maduekwe was automatically disqualified from contract in the Ministry of Transport, but I said Caesar's wife must be above suspicion. There should be no conflict of interest. They were Nigerian, they're entitled to have contracts, but let them go and look for it elsewhere. And I said, look, any of my officers who decided to say, this is for the minister, this is for, you'll be in trouble. I lived what I said, and many years since I left the Minister of Transport, nobody has come up with any evidence to say, don't mind this hypocrite. You know, these are his three houses in London, two in New York, five in Toronto. Nobody has, because there's no evidence. And it's not for want of trying to find whether there's anything to use to contradict this man. So, it's still something I feel very passionate about, because we are not in public service to line up our pockets. If anybody is not comfortable with his salary as a minister, then resign and go into the private sector. But as long as you agree to serve the nation in any capacity, minister, a high ambassador, high commissioner, or whatever, serve 24/7. Even doing private business is against the code of conduct. It's even a form of corruption. Stick to your salary. Manage it and serve your nation, because it's a privilege you have You are only one out of 170 million people.
When you look at other places, you know, you've been minister in a couple of ministries. When you look at other places, how do you think other people have fared in this ideal of good governance, you know, anti-corruption, and putting the nations first?
You know, that's a very good question, a very, very important question. Briefly, let me put it this way. Nigeria, the Nigeria we are looking for today, the Nigeria we are wishing we have today, we had it some time ago. There was a time when you could leave your car open, you come back, you drive it and go. There was a time while you are still in university, you didn't need to know anybody, you are in the graduating class. You are given forms to fill to join the Federal Public Service, and you got a job. You didn't need to know anybody. So what we are looking for is already in our DNA. But what has happened is that because of, let's blame it on the Civil War. The Civil War brought enormous dislocation to our national and public psyche. And since then, we have been operating a zero-consequence political culture and society. So the thing to do is to take Nigeria back. It doesn't require too much to do that. Take Nigeria back to a rule-driven society, a society where the regime of reward and punishment is quite well established and is quite clear. A Nigeria where hard work matters and merit should be celebrated. Because at the end of the day, if we celebrate hard work and celebrate merit, there will be a rising tide that will lift everybody up. But if what we do is to change the goalposts because of who is involved, oh, this person is from my village, or from my tribe, or maybe we go to the same church or the same mosque, then we will continue democratize misery and poverty and suffering. Because even the rich will continue to cry in a place like Nigeria because of the opportunities we will have missed as a nation to really grow the economy, create prosperity, and be able to harvest abundance. It's an ethical issue. And I think the issue of ethical reengineering of the Nigerian state is more important than anything else. It doesn't really matter which party. You know, I was national secretary of the then ruling party, PDP. And part of my frustration was that how often did we sit down to discuss the issues of governance? How often did we sit down to even talk about corruption? You know, which was an ideology of the party. The anti-corruption thing was put together by a president elected by the PDP. And yet we were not talking about fighting corruption. We didn't take credit as a party for what our president had done in fighting corruption. So, and I believe that political parties, speaking now as a party, a former party administrator, the reason they talk for political parties is to talk about the issues of governance. Why they want power. There has to be purpose to power. Power without principle is a travesty of politics. And once you get it right in the area of concepts and principles, even the way contracts are awarded, who gets the contract, and how the contracts are implemented, they all flow automatically. When I was Minister of Transport, I must say I was not a particularly popular Minister of Transport, and I have no apology for that, because my lack of popularity was that you are my friend, you want contract. I say, well, I don't give contract. A minister is not supposed to award contract. A minister is supposed to deal with policy. You want contract, look at the bidding, go into the bidding process. And if the due process people, they think you are the best, why not? My own, if the contract is beyond the amount I can spend as a minister, I'll take it to the Federal Executive Council. And most of them will, whether it's buying patrol boats for the ports or dredging the ports and all that. These are huge sums of money, billions of naira worth of contracts. Only the cabinet can approve. But there has to be a bidding process. If you are the best, we'll take it and go there. But to approach myself because you are my friend or you're from my village and all that, I should just pull out the contract from the briefcase and give you. No, I won't do that. Well, I'm not sharing money with you anyway. I made it clear. So my only interest is that you do a good job. So how do we begin to, and I wasn't the only one. I don't want to set myself out, make myself look more spare than everybody else. Mine was particularly visible or prominent because it was about transport. Transportation is big, ports, railway, maritime and all that. And I was ideological enough to speak about what I was doing and the philosophy that was driving it. So that made me sometimes controversial, not just because I decided to ride bicycle to the Executive Council. So what we need to do is let the narrative about what governance is all about, let it be readdressed by both the current ruling party, APC, PDP, that is now the official opposition, and all the other parties. Let there be a common ground amongst politicians, so why they are in politics. That will make our debates less inelegant and less abusive. And so the electorate will have clear reasons to vote for one party and not the other. But if we don't discuss that, and we are just looking at this thing as power for the sake of personal or ethnic relevance, then it's a very thin line between that and the corruption of power and the national security implications of corruption, because there's a linkage between corruption and national security challenge.
You were party secretary, you were minister of transportation and culture and tourism, and then you became foreign minister, and everybody felt that that was the apogee, that was the height of a career, like you said previously, 16 years of meritorious service in public service. And then everybody said, that's it. Maybe Ojo Maduekwe is going to become a presidential candidate of any of the parties, including the PDP, of which you were not just an integral member, but you were its scribe. And then out of the blues, you became High Commissioner to Canada. And a lot of people began to say, how can this man be Minister of Foreign Affairs and then come back and serve under another Minister of Foreign Affairs? So are there lessons that you have learned from this transition?
For me, it's about service. And I'm happy I came here. Like I have said let me put this way, President Jonathan, before I came here, I went to see him. We're discussing something else about the party and all that. Then he raised the question. He said, you've been Minister of Foreign Affairs, dealing with the whole world. How will you now be able to adjust being ambassador, high commissioner, to just one country, after the many, many countries you used to handle their affairs well? He just wondered how I would cope. I said, well, Mr. President, when I was Minister of Foreign Affairs, I was dealing with the whole forest. Nothing to do with the trees. The trees were being handled by my ambassadors. Now I'm going to one tree called Canada to understand that tree. How does any of the trees in the forest operate? So it will complete my education as a diplomat. Coming to Canada has been a wonderful opportunity to step out a bit from the Nigerian space and understand Nigeria better, even from here. It's also been an opportunity to understand the public service better.
You are 70 years old, and like you said, you possibly will be leaving Canada whenever the president asks you to return home. So are you going to join President Obasanjo in Otter Farm, raising chickens, or are you going to make Ohafia the custom or the customary melting pot of Nigeria?
Great question, Tunde. Maybe a little bit of all of that. President Obasanjo, of course, is my hero, my mentor, apart from having been my boss. I admire him greatly. We don't always agree, and he knows that. And but that part of the attraction, he's able to tolerate my independence of mind. I like the way he has remained active in retirement. Another model, again, not somebody I always agree with all he does, says Henry Kissinger. I was at an event in Toronto some 6 months ago, I think, and Henry Kissinger was there at the age of 91. He came looking strong, and I had just read his new book, he wrote at the age of 91. And for 1 hour, he was on the podium with Fariz Zakaria. I said, wow, 91, still active. He's not going to some place, home corner of the world. In the case of Nigeria, we say our village, just to go and wait for death. So these are some of the examples that inspire me. I have the intention of, in retirement, just going to wait for the day the Lord calls me home. I don't know when, but I don't have to worry about when it will be. But ideally, I would like to be active till the last day I am in this world. Part of it will mean being in my village to impact on my community in more specific ways than I had the time to do before. To the extent there will be a little bit of farming involved, a la Obasanjo, that'd be great. So Abuja will always be the central place. And in Abuja, I will continue to engage not only with politicians of PDP extraction, but also politicians in other parties. I remain PDP, I will always be PDP, I don't see myself moving to any other party. But there's too much politics in my blood to make me now say I'm done with politics. But I intend to continue to facilitate what has always been my passion, even long before when I was in SDP, what I call the bipartisan imperative. Nigeria needs a bipartisan platform. All the big issues of the day, whether it's corruption or now the insecurity issue or infrastructure deficit, none of them can be tackled purely from a partisan platform.
We have been speaking to His Excellency Ojo Maduekwe, the Nigerian High Commissioner to Canada, and he has been frank, he has been forthright as usual, and if he pulled punches, that's just because that's the way he is. We'd like to say a big thank you to you, our viewers, for giving us this opportunity, and also to our host for granting us this interview. Thank you very much. This is how far we go on this edition, and until we see you again, bye.